Good morning and welcome to the 34th meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2023. Today we have received apologies from the convener, Claire Adamson, MSP, so I will be chairing today's meeting. We've also received apologies from Mark Ruskell, MSP. Claire Adamson is substituted by Jim Fairley, MSP. Welcome to the committee, Jim, and as this is your first time attending this committee, can I invite you to make any declaration of interests?
Mark, convener, thank you very much. I have no interest to declare. Thank you.
Thank you for that. We turn now to agenda item one, which is a decision on taking business in private. Are members content that we take item three on the agenda in private? Thank you. We turn to agenda item two, which is the historic environment strategy and an evidence session on that subject. We are taking evidence on our past, our future, the strategy for Scotland's historic environment, and are joined this morning by Christina McKelvey, MSP, Minister for Culture, Europe and International Development, and she is supported by Chris Rafferty, Head of Sponsorship and Historic Environment, Scottish Government. A very warm welcome to you both. And Minister, can I invite you to make a short opening statement?
Yep, thank you very much, convener, and please pass on my best wishes to both Mark and Claire, if you can. Thank you for inviting me to give evidence to your committee today. And as the Our Past, Our Future strategy makes clear, our historic environment is a national asset, intrinsically linked to our sense of self and national identity, and it's of great importance to Scotland. And I know from the many questions I've had from members over the past few weeks, it holds a warm place in everyone's heart for the lovely attractions and assets that they have in their own constituencies. This strategy acknowledges just how unique and diverse Scotland's historic environment sector is. Our historic environment is of international significance, designated through our World Heritage Sites and iconic heritage attractions that are instantly recognisable and eternally memorable. I feel it's important to reflect back on Scotland's first historic environment strategy, Our Place in Time, which was published in 2014. Our Place in Time has had a very positive impact on the awareness and perceptions of the priorities within and outside of the historic environment sector. It provides a framework around which Historic Environment Scotland and other stakeholders aligned strategic planning and develop other strategies. However, since Our Place in Time was published, we can all recognise that a lot has changed, with the sector facing fresh challenges and opportunities. Our Past, Our Future focuses on priorities that have been identified through extensive consultation with the historic environment and cross-cutting sectors, as well as communities across Scotland. For me, as a former Equalities Minister, you'll not be surprised that participation is a key element of all of that work. It is telling that these key priorities source from active engagement within the sector, aligned with the Scottish Government's national goals and targets, which include delivering net zero, building a wellbeing economy, and creating more resilient, inclusive, and sustainable communities and places. Now to the challenges. We all recognise the challenges around climate change, the shortage of traditional skills, and the current economic climate. The need to address skills shortages within the historic environment sector has become even more important and pressing. We are all too aware of the high-level masonry issues that we have been facing as a result of worsening climate change. And, of course, we need traditional skills to maintain and retrofit our traditional buildings if we are to achieve our net zero targets and maintain our building stock for the future. There is a lot of good work currently being undertaken in this area, including on the Make Your Mark volunteering campaign and at the Ridge in Dunbar. To ensure Scotland's built heritage is sustainable and promotes wellbeing, we will be continuing to engage with the sector to understand the ways in which we can support actions around our national targets. And I want to make it clear, convener, that the Scottish Government continues to recognise the important contribution that the heritage sector makes to our economy and our wellbeing. Against the challenges of the financial backdrop, we will therefore continue to provide funding to the sector through our sponsorship of Historic Environment Scotland to support these key areas. A key part of the work that I want to do going forward and the work that has been done in the past is about collaboration and how we work together on all of this. So I think it's really important that as we deliver this work, we work together to create opportunities to sustain and enhance the benefits that our nation's heritage creates, and ensure that the historic environment is at the centre of our national life. And my recent work with the convener of the Wellbeing Board of COSLA is an example of that collaboration. I think we must communicate better the significance of our historic environment and the contribution that the sector makes to the economy and to the wellbeing of Scotland's people. This strategy was created by everyone, for everyone, and therefore we'll have all our part, we all have our part to play in its delivery. Our past or future does not exist in isolation. It fits within the context of a number of other Scottish Government strategies, such as the Programme for Government, National Planning Framework 4, and the Culture Strategy. However, we can do more with our past, our future, and mainstreaming across other areas of government, and we will. That's one thing that I have taken up as a personal action to do. In conclusion, Convener, it's important that these challenges and opportunities around delivering our past or future are all considered, which is why I'm pleased to be here today and open for the open discussion and any questions. And I thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister, for that statement. If I could begin the questions and ask you about the impact of closures and restricted access. HES updated the committee last week that around 20 sites are remaining closed, and I think you gave answers to questions in the chamber yesterday about this, that there are still sites with restrictions in place. That obviously has an effect on tourism and the local economy, and I just wondered if the Scottish Government has firstly done any analysis of the impact of closures and restrictions, and secondly, if any support is available to communities affected by such closures or restrictions.
Yeah, I know this has been an issue very close to your heart, Convener, and many members, not just of this committee, but across the Chamber. And I did give a bit of an update when I answered Ros McCall's question yesterday. We have had, obviously, the high-level masonry issues, which resulted in 70 buildings being impacted by that. We're now at the stage where 53 are either opened or partially opened, and Historic Environment Scotland have confirmed to me that they expect all of those inspections and that work to be finished by March next year, which is ever closer as we move through this swiftly through this year. You asked the question about analysis. HES are doing analysis on this constantly. They're always reviewing. They've looked at different ways to speed up inspection processes, to get more detailed inspections completed, and therefore more detailed work done too, including using technology. So I was along to visit Tantallon Castle in the summer when it reopened to the public and was shown some of the damage that the climate change is doing there. But they talked about the way that they've used drones to identify issues that have come up, but actually getting a person up there has been much more fruitful, because sometimes the drone doesn't tell you everything than getting a human pair of eyes and hands on what that looks and feels like, and they've been doing much of that. All of the different sites have different needs and different issues. So they've been working very closely with us and obviously with all of the sites to identify those issues as quickly as possible, to find the remedies, to fix them as quickly as possible, and then obviously to get them opened to the public in a safe manner. So that's ongoing, and they update their website constantly with the latest inspection data and updates there, and be happy to give you and the committee that website in order to access that information as it's updated, because it's updated quite swiftly. So keeping on top of it all through communications with me is one way, but the other way is to update the public through their website.
And in terms of supporting local communities who might have been affected by that, what can the Scottish Government do?
So much of the work that has been done in, around some of these sites has been with local communities. It's what do you want to see from your historic site? How would you like to see the access? Enabling people to understand why it's safe or it's not safe, and asking them how they view their site. Nabs along at Tintallan Castle that day, there was many members of the public there, and I asked a few of them who'd climbed up to the parapets the same as me to get the view of the damage that you can see coming in off the sea from there. And many of them were saying, you know, it's a really great place to come and visit. What's interesting is, what I found is some of the issues that arose was tourists knew a bit more about local sites than maybe local people did. So some of that educational work about what's on your doorstep and how important it is. And I think during the pandemic, those sites became really important for people, because for most of them, it was a daily walk. It was, you know, getting to know what's in your community. And I think that's really important. So that point I made in my open remarks about participation and how we work with local communities, both to inform them on the process of what's happening with inspections, but then to inform them on how we're reopening and making them safe and how they can use them in a safe way too.
Secondly, can I ask you about the phrase managed decline, which is mentioned? You reference climate change and the transition to net zero in your opening statement. Is managed decline of sites, basically letting them, you know, kind of decline or degrade naturally, is that part of the Scottish Government strategy as far as you're aware, or is it something that you'd like to avoid?
It's not a term I've ever used, and it's not a term actually I have heard since I came into this job in March. It's a term that I've heard spoken about, but not from the people who are managing the sites, I have to say. There's a lot of positivity. Yes, there's challenges, but there are so many opportunities, and how we you know, use those opportunities to both give people a sense of their place in their own communities, but also you know, for Scotland on the international stage. I mentioned in my open remarks as well about how Scotland is viewed. Everybody knows Edinburgh Castle, Stirling Castle, the Wallace Monument, you know, the iconic ones, but some people don't know what's on their own doorstep, and you know, doing that work with people locally is important to that. But managed decline is not the attitude that I'm seeing from this. It's very, very positive, with, you know, opportunities to raise awareness of what's happening in all of these sites, and to use them as exemplars as well. And I'll go back to Tintallan Castle, because it's a very tangible example of that. When I was there, they talked about repairs that had been done in the past and the methods that had been used to repair in the past, which was quite a rough-looking cement. But the sandstone around the cement had degraded and worn away, and these big chunks of cement were sticking out, you know. And they were looking at ways, you know, to look at that. So that didn't seem like managed decline to me. That seems like, you know, securing all of these sites for a future, and a future where we can use them to their best of their ability.
Good. Can I turn now to questions from colleagues? And can I begin by asking Alexander Stewart to ask questions?
Thank you, Deputy Convener. Good morning, Minister. You spoke about, in your opening statement, about the effective engagement, collaboration and partnership, and I think these are all vital. And last week we had the opportunity to hear from Alex Paterson and Dr. Jackson about the effectiveness and how they believe that that is crucial for the strategy to succeed. But one of the difficulties that has arisen is that there's not really an effective engagement sometimes through local authority. Some local authorities may well be supportive and others are not. And there was talk of trying to achieve the Local Authority Historic Environment Group. Now, that didn't actually succeed in becoming a structure that was used. And that is seen as a potential barrier to the engagement within local authorities. So can I ask you how important that role should be, that local government, because with them working in collaboration and partnership, it works well. But if it doesn't, then there's a gap. And that gap then creates the complexities for the sector. And the strategy will then not succeed if there is not that cooperation and engagement taking place.
If First of all, I'll agree with you that participation is incredibly important, and you'll know that the strategy was developed over the summer of 2022 with participation at the heart of that. So it wasn't just Historic Environment Scotland, it was the Scottish Government, it was Built Environment Forum, it was many other organisations and people who have an interest, and there was a public consultation at that point as well, and we then published, or HES published their, let me get the report name correct, you said we did report, and that was a way to convey back to people their ideas that were engaged with that whole consultation process and how important they were, and some of those issues from people not knowing what was on their doorstep, and then getting to know what's on their doorstep came through that. But I did mention in my response to the convener about my intention to work very closely with local authorities. Many of our properties in care that HES look after are also looked after by local authorities. I've got Chatelaro in my constituency, for instance. It's incredibly well looked after by South Lanarkshire Council. That's one example. You'll all have examples in your constituency of where that is the case, that partnership between local government and Historic Environment Scotland, and therefore the Scottish Government, it becomes incredibly important in that. But one of the things that I wanted to do when I came into this role was to reinvigorate the Cultural Conveners Chairs Forum, which we have done. So we have now met. We decided immediately that we needed to have some sort of a event, which will happen in the new year, looking at how we work together, but also looking at the value of culture in all of our lives. It'd be called a Culture Value Summit. Pretty straightforward name there for that. But that does become very important. I'm really interested in your historic environment group that you mentioned. That's not something that I've heard of or came up from any of the culture conveners that I met with them all, I think, in that last meeting just a few weeks ago. But I will pick up that point on the historic environment group and see where that got to. If you think about big cities like Edinburgh or Glasgow, where historic environment is around them everywhere. In fact, most of them are working in buildings that are historic environment city chambers that are incredibly important buildings as well. But you know, some of the challenges that come if there's issues with those buildings and local authorities are involved in the clean-up and the restoration and all of that. So that partnership is incredibly important to me. I want to strengthen it, I want to grow it, but I want to make it much more dynamic, I think, in how we work together, but also how we tackle the challenges that are coming down the road. And we can only do that in partnership. There's no way being separate from local government on this would deal with those challenges. But I will take away the issue about the Historic Environment Group and speak to Councillor Maureen Chalmers, who I'm working very closely with on this. She's the Chair of the Wellbeing Board.
And to make everything work, you know, we need to have the resources, the manpower and the finances to, and we touched on in the past about short and medium term financial planning for the organisation as to how it will progress, because if it doesn't have that stability in the financial sector for themselves, then they're not able to achieve some of the goals that they're trying to. You've already indicated that government are supportive of where they want to go, but there still seems to be quite a gap between what the aspirations are for the organisation, for where we want to see the strategy, but that can only be achieved if there is the backup from either the funding from local government or from national government, or from sponsorship or from entrepreneurs or from individuals who give legacies or whatever, to ensure that, because as I said, without that, Minister, the strategy will not succeed, and areas that do have all of that engagement and all of that financial support will manage much better than the ones who are on the periphery. You've talked about the centre of Edinburgh, maybe Edinburgh and Glasgow having much more of that. But in the rural area where we have many locally attractions and institutions that are trying to support and we've talked about in the past about sponsorship, and we've talked about how that's managed, and also people volunteering to give their time and their talents to make sure that something is restored or kept within a community. But as I say, without the financial backup, it really does become a mountain for these organisations to climb, and it would be useful to hear what your views are on some of that.
You'll not be surprised to hear me saying that the current budget round is incredibly tough. But putting that aside for a second, in 2023-24, the operational budget for HES has risen by 18% to £114.5 million. So I think that shows a level of commitment. High-level masonry issues, obviously the budget around about that has risen dramatically too. And again, you know, a recognition of, you know, we need to invest here for all of our futures. We're coming into a new budget round. The draft budget will be published on the 19th of December. I'm sure this committee, amongst many others, will take their opportunity to have their say in that. And I would encourage you to do so. You picked up the point about sponsorship. I think there's a bit of work to be done around that, and I know that the committee's looked at this from other questions over the last few weeks, that you've been thinking about how do we maximise the income. Interestingly, Hez have suggested that they've had a very strong recovery from COVID, which is good to hear, because it's been hard for many people to recover from COVID, but they're seeing that strong recovery coming in too. That revenue raising, you know, coming up to, you know, those levels again. One of the challenges that we have with HES is the way in which they were set up in the beginning, where, you know, if the revenue goes beyond a certain amount, you know, that then has an impact on the money they get from government. They're currently working on a new plan, a new model for business and the way that they do their business. And we're looking at where we can build some flexibilities into that in order for them to do more around about revenue raising and sponsorship and all of the issues that can arise from that, but very positive, you know, relationships that they have maybe around the world. Our, you know, Scottish Connections framework is a perfect example of how we can use the numbers are 40, 50 or 60 million, depending who you speak to, of people who believe they have Scottish roots and therefore a connection with Scotland as well. So there's many ways in which we can use much of that network, but some of it depends on this new business model, and we're currently working with HES and how we can build on that and build in those flexibilities, allow for those things to take part. You mentioned volunteering, which ties into the point that I responded to the convener on about local communities. And local communities are sometimes the best custodians of what's on their doorstep, as well as maybe some communities who are not too sure what's on their doorstep. But when you get local communities involved in looking after their local heritage assets, they become the best custodians in that sense. And we want to encourage that, develop that further and work with HES and others in order to create those opportunities, not just for folk that have got a bit of time in their hands, but, you know, for young people, for older people, to make the places accessible for all of these groups, including disability groups. I mean, the amount of events that happen within Shatlero in my constituency is absolutely unbelievable. And we had a serious issue of badger baiting, believe it or not. And we engaged all the primary schools on badger watch, and the badger baiting stopped. So when you engage a community into looking after their not just the building, but the land and the landscape around it, they become the best guardians of that. So we want to encourage much more of that.
Thank you, Deputy Convener.
Thank you. Could I turn now to Neil Bibby?
Thank you. Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. You mentioned in opening the shortage of skills and how that's become an even more important issue over the last few years. Brian, and you talked about the financial situation earlier as well and understanding the key issues facing the sector. And I think investment in skills is one of those key areas. Brian Dixon, Head of Buildings Policy at the National Trust for Scotland, expressed a view that while the review of the skills investment plan should create some positive action, there needed to be more investment in this area. He also argued that the concerns of the historic environment sector need to be more mainstream to ensure areas like skills training have enough support. To follow on from Alexander Stewart's question there, I noted what you said about how the budget had increased for Historic Environment Scotland and in relation to stonemasonry as well. Do you agree with the evidence that we've received that there does need to be more investment in skills?
So I think there's a combination of things going on here, because we have obviously challenges around the skills in this area generally. One of the issues that has arisen is creating the opportunities in which young people and other people can develop those skills. I met with Graham Day just yesterday with Historic Environment Scotland team, his officials and my officials, because we've been working over the last few months on all of those concerns that have been brought up, and with the Verity, the Verity review and the other work that Graham Day has spoken about just in his statement the other day of developing skills in the skills landscape. We've been working very closely to look at ways in which we can tackle some of the challenges around this. When it comes to apprenticeships for these areas, particularly stonemasonry, you're talking about a maximum of 30 apprentices a year. You know, it's 27 sitting right now. Working very closely with Skills Development Scotland, the Scottish Funding Council and CITB in order to develop the framework. There's a bit of work going on right now as well to look at the qualification framework and whether that reflects professionalism and the way in which we want to hold those skills in our training formats. We've agreed to go and look at that with SQA. And how we develop that professional framework. So that's a piece of work that's been undergoing right now that makes the whole apprenticeship programme for people seeking those skills much more attractive when the qualifications are of those standards. So that's a piece of work that we're working on right now, and I just met with Graham Day yesterday on that. I mean, I don't deny those challenges here. And there's challenges in how we deliver some of this work in a rural setting. So you'll know that Historic Environment Scotland are working with CITB and others in Elgin and in Stirling at the engine shed and the work that they are doing there. And one of the conversations we've been having is around having a centre of excellence. There's nothing, you know, agreed on this yet, but exploring all of the ideas that will create the circumstances in which people will be encouraged to come into this role and then to create the framework in which they have the qualifications going out on the other side. And we're continuing those conversations over the next few weeks with Mr. Day and his team and Hez, and I'm meeting with Hez next week to follow up on all of this too. So it's a very live issue right now. Nothing's been agreed yet, but lots of ideas have been coming in. And if you've got some of your own, please share.
So thanks for that answer. I mean, I think it's clear we do need a greater investment in skills, and that's certainly the evidence that we've received. I think perhaps, you know, and I welcome the meetings you're having with Mr. Day, and I suppose, and that is positive. I suppose what the sector's looking for and you know, people widen that probably looking for is more details and more targets and more specifics in relation to how are we going to address the problems that are there. So I appreciate you saying that, you know, no things have been agreed yet, but in terms of, you know, clearly we've got skills investment shortages in stonemasonry, but I think as well in terms of traditional joiners, lime plasterers, historic gardeners, surveyors, archaeologists. In terms of, you know, we're hearing we need more investment in skills, but we also, I think we need more clarity from the government as to where we're going in relation to that and what are, if any, you mentioned numbers in relation to apprenticeships in stonemasonry earlier. Are there, you know, if we're accepting there is a skill shortage, what analysis has the government done of what that shortage is and what targets are there going to be to address them?
Yeah, we're currently working on that information as we speak. Historic Environment Scotland have recently, 13th of November, engaged a new team, a programme management team, which includes a data analyst whose job is to look at all of those issues and look at the skills gaps in which they emerge for Historic Environment Scotland. The other piece of work that you're looking for is within the skills sector, and I will, rather than me trying to pull out the back of my head what Mr. Day is doing around about this as well, I'll endeavour to get that information and send it on to the committee. But for our purposes and the purpose of the strategy, you know, we recognise that traditional skills gaps exist. We recognise that we need those traditional skills to be built into what we do. There's 2 million stone-built structures in Scotland. 2 million, which means over the course of the next few years, particularly with the acceleration of climate change, we need more people to be engaged in those skills areas, both to protect, repair and improve our structures. And I think there is currently no training provision in Scotland for repair and maintenance skills in these key areas, and that's one of the issues that we discussed yesterday, about how do we create the circumstances in which we can create the training for that. And that will be, you know, around about an apprenticeship model, a shared apprenticeship model, continuous professional development for people who are already qualified in these areas. So we're looking very closely at all of this, and the new data analyst for HES, I think maybe the 13th of November, he started his work. So I think we'll give him the new year, and then we'll start to ask him about what analysis that he's pulling out and what it's telling him. And that data will then be able to inform our next steps. But we're well aware there's an issue there, and I think HES are starting to address that with these new engagements.
Okay, well, thanks. I welcome the answers. Obviously, I think we do need to understand more about the actual shortfalls in terms of skills and in terms of the investment that's required. So I look forward to receiving details on that.
So if I could just come in on that, we had, I think, very compelling evidence from Brian Dixon of the National Trust for Scotland, who said, this was 2 weeks ago, even if the NTS had the finances to deliver large-scale capital works across Scotland, I do not think that we would have the skills available in Scotland to do so. And that, I think, is very significant. I just wondered if you had any observations on the kind of urgency of this sort of gap in the market, as it were.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think there's a recognition that there is a challenge there, and there's a recognition that we have to do something about it. I hope there's a recognition now from the committee about the work that I've spoken about over the last few months, and that just yesterday in the follow-up meeting with HES next week gives you a demonstration of how urgent I see this issue, and how we want to create the circumstances in which we do that. One of the things that I picked up on a recent trip to Paris was how Notre Dame was being. It's amazing how when you come into a new portfolio and you start to see things that become very relevant to the issues within your portfolio. And I went along to see the work that's been done at Notre Dame to restore that, and the way that they've engaged an apprenticeship programme in that whole project. So you'll start your apprenticeship at the beginning of that project and end it on that project. And what a great thing to have on your CV that you restored Notre Dame. So I asked our officials in the Paris office to go and have a look at that, if there's any learning from that we can use in the way in which they have engaged those apprentices. You know, I think somebody would quite like to have I've worked on Edinburgh Castle or the Wallace Monument on their CV, and that the experience that brings to them as well. So it's about making that offer much more exciting, I think, for people who would maybe not think about these careers when they're embarking on both their further and higher education learning, or even into jobs and apprenticeships. They may not think about these careers, and that maybe gives them an opportunity to think about these careers, but the opportunities that it brings, and the prestige that it brings with it as well. So it's not just about filling the gaps, in a perfunctory way. It's about making the whole offer much more attractive to encourage people to come into the sector as well. And that's the work that they will be, we're all picking up on now.
Thank you. Can I ask Jim Fairley?
Thank you. It's just a wee curiosity. I know we've just finished building our house, and stonemason was absolutely the biggest problem we had, getting people to come in to do stonemasonry. Do you know if the new immigration system from the government in the UK allows stonemasonry in the skill set that are allowed to allow people to come? Because obviously there are big gaps. You said there's 2 million buildings that are built with stone in this country. We don't have enough. We definitely don't have enough stonemasons. So are we able to bring people in from European countries with the requisite skills to be able to help fill the gaps?
Well, that's always an opportunity and something that I would welcome and agree to. I think given the announcements in the last few days on the new immigration measures that the UK government want to take, that makes that process much, much more difficult. The earnings threshold is a barrier in its own, but they've just scrapped that list that they had of skills gaps in areas where we needed more skills. I've just said they're going to scrap that list. So that whole, encouraging people to come from other parts of the world into Scotland to work on these amazing assets has just become much, much harder.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Could I turn now to Keith Brown, please?
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I was pleased to hear you say you're looking at the issue of when HES might make more money, as they have been doing, that they're able to keep that money, because that is a real incentive for them to do more work. But the committee, not that it's down to me to speak on behalf of the committee, but I think the committee was a bit concerned in recent weeks, speaking to HES and others, that when this issue was raised, the idea of exploiting to a greater extent the facilities that they have, how would I put this, it wasn't exactly jumped upon as a huge opportunity. But given what you said and what we all know about the budget situation, surely some greater vigour and urgency around seizing opportunities to maximise income from other sources should really be, I would imagine, jumped upon by HES. Is there any reassurance you can give the committee that that will be supported by, encouraged by and facilitated by ministers as a matter of some urgency?
Yeah, thanks very much. Excellent question, and leads on from the questions earlier about, and my response about the new model in which HES are developing. Scottish Government officials are working with them on that. We are supporting them to do that, as obviously the sponsorship body. They are in the throes of redeveloping that business model as we speak, and they want to ensure that that delivers a high quality, sustainable and equitable service for the people of Scotland. And what that means is to deliver that high quality, but that sustainability becomes even more important, particularly in the current financial environment where everyone is feeling it tough when it comes to budget. So the Built Environment Forum in Scotland have created a sustainable investment toolkit that any of our organisations in historic heritage can use. That was created on behalf of the predecessor strategy on this, the Our Time in Our Place in Time. Yeah, Our Place in Time strategy. So that toolkit has been designed to both assess societal and economic opportunities and obviously the environmental potential of our built heritage too. I think for HES's point of view, I explained earlier about the way in which they are made that creates some of those challenges, and if they raise additional revenue, that then has an impact on their grant that they get from government, and that's just the legal framework in the way in which they were set up. What we are doing right now is working very closely with them. As I said, officials are supporting them with this work to look at the financial forecasts, the income forecasts, how that can be increased without that impact on their grant aid from the Scottish Government, and how that can disincentivise. So I'm not really surprised that they were not that forthcoming, because the current business model doesn't allow them to take full advantage of those opportunities. And we're working with them right now with finance and Exchequer colleagues to look at ways in which we can create flexibilities in which we can do that. I think in a very tough financial environment, opportunities for revenue raising become very important, particularly for that sustainability, but also for investment into those assets as well, and the ability for HES to hold reserves, and you know, all of that. All of these things are all in play when we are looking at that. HES are also leading the way a bit on public sector reform and public services reform, particularly as a public body and in the landscape in which they sit right now. So we're looking at ways in which they can become an exemplar for other public bodies, looking at new and innovative and flexible ways in which they can raise more of their revenue and raise the profile and the understanding of some of the amazing heritage that we have, and then how they can invest that back into the work that they are doing, particularly around about preserving, sustaining and maintaining those cultural assets for the future.
Well, thanks very much for that. And that is encouraging, but I think first of all, I would just say, and it's maybe not true of all the committee, the idea of public bodies accumulating reserves for no apparent purpose is not something I'm very supportive of, but there'll be different views on that. I think what I'm really keen to see, though, and I think the committee will look at this, I'm sure, in future, is given the assets which are there, it requires, I think, a kind of change in mindset so that imagination, entrepreneurialism takes place. If you think about, everyone talks about, as I did last week, Bad B, for example, in the Highlands, but the ones which are very important to people in North America from the clearances. But there's also the Hanseatic League links, which parts of Scotland have got along the road. You've got Picardy Place, which is a link with Edinburgh, with the French region. China, I mean, the presence of Scots and the banking institutions in Hong Kong and so on. So if somebody took the, you know, sites which are very important, which are within his, and then started to look at a complete audit of what they have, and also actually some places which they don't currently have, then if they were properly exploited, and it could also be done through fundraising, if you think of some of the corporate entities around the world that might be willing to contribute, it could transform the money they have to develop and maintain and improve access to their sites. So I suppose what would be really useful to know is if the government would be willing to encourage HES to have a kind of complete fresh audit of what those opportunities might be in relation to every site. And I know they've got an awful lot of sites, but they could probably start with a priority list, if that kind of approach was possible.
Yeah, I think any positive approach is possible. I suspect HES have been, their imagination has been tempered by the current legal setup that they have for their operating model. And from 24-25, they will have some flexibility within that, you know, which maybe open that Pandora's box of imagination and how we can use all of these things. I hear you on the diaspora Hanseatic League links that we have with other nations. China is one you mentioned as well. And that our new Scottish Connections framework, I think, is a great vehicle for how we use some of those examples that you have just spoken about, and how we raise the profile, market, you know, use, and you use the word exploit, you know, use all of those iconic, you know, in some cases, backdrops for revenue raising and, you know, sponsorship and fundraising and, you know, clans maybe coming back and taking some responsibility and funding and supporting, you know, cultural heritage in which they are connected to. So I think there's a rich seam in there that can certainly be mined. I intend to do that. I think we need to settle the issue around about the operating model to allow us to be as adventurous and as imaginative as possible. I'm keen to do that as well. So I'll take up an action from today to sit down with the Scottish Connections team and the work that they're doing right now on diaspora and how we can use that with some of these iconic and maybe not so iconic places that we can use for all of that. The question on a complete audit, I'll have to go back and check whether that's something. I think they audit all the time. I think they keep track of things like that all the time. But maybe your audit that you're thinking about, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, is about looking at fresh opportunities in which to use those that you're nodding. So let me take that away as an action in how we look at that. You'll have known by, and I know it's nothing to do with the committee last week, that Alex Patterson's decided to move on, and there's an opportunity for a new CEO to come in, you know, a fresh leadership there, and maybe a fresh pair of eyes and an opportunity with the new operating model and some of the ideas in which we can use to really create our place and time in all of these wonderful assets that we've got and how we use them. That new CEO is maybe an opportunity to do that. But I'll probably place on record now, convening, if you don't mind, my thanks to Alex Patterson for the work that he's done, because he's managed, you know, through very, very difficult circumstances over the past few years to keep this organisation moving and to keep things, you know, going. You know, but there's always opportunities and change, and those opportunities, I think, should be positive.
Okay, I wasn't aware that Alex Patterson had moved on, and I hope the grilling from this committee last week didn't play a role in that.
I'm sure it wasn't.
No, well, we are grateful for the evidence that he gave. And from a personal perspective, I completely endorse what Keith Brown was saying about the need to kind of turbocharge the possibilities that we all know exist around. you know, trying to generate revenue from, you know, abroad or the private sector, whatever it might be. And I think it's a really, really important and significant aspect of what we've done it so far. Can I turn to Kate Forbes, please?
Thanks very much. Thank you, Minister. I have a question about the very laudable aims of the strategy. And I think, in a sense, the strategy picks up on aims which should really be aims that all of Scotland is pulling together to try and deliver in terms of transition to net zero, resilient communities and building a wellbeing economy. But I put it to Alex Paterson that perhaps one of the most obvious aims that you would expect, which is the preservation of historical buildings, wasn't one of the aims. And he, of course, said that that's almost in our DNA, which makes sense. But I wondered if you sensed any legitimate tension that as Historic Environment Scotland do try and meet these aims, would that have an impact, for example, even on financially, on how they might be able to expand their portfolio? So, for example, if they have to use their resources in terms of reducing emissions and making some of their current properties more energy efficient, that inevitably might absorb income. So rather than spreading themselves too thinly, is the point I'm making, they can invest more in their current portfolio. And I wondered if you thought that was right or you think that's flawed.
I don't think it's flawed. I don't think it's flawed. I think there is all of those challenges, current and on the horizon, of the impact of climate on all of our buildings. And I explained that situation with Tantallon Castle and the wear on the building and the seawall and the bad repairs that had been done in the past. So, you know, taking account of some of that. I agree with Alex Paterson that I think preservation is in the DNA of everything that we are doing. This is all about how we maintain, sustain and, you know, preserve our cultural heritage for future generations. How we do that is the approach that we take in a sustainable way. And that will be different for different examples of, the materials in which those buildings are made from. And much of, the point that I picked up with Neil Bibby about how important these skills are and how we preserve it and take those challenges forward to resolution. It is around, in the last 50 years or so, we've used much more different materials in which to build in ways we build. In our cultural heritage, we built from the ground. You know, it was things that were around us in our communities that people built from. And going back to some of those ideas and how those buildings were created and how those landscapes were created and using those traditional ways in which to preserve them as well. But also using innovation and how we use innovation. I mentioned the fact that drone footage has been used to get to places where maybe it's been difficult to get to, but actually that's not, the be-all and end-all. It's not the best way in some ways for a pair of eyes and a pair of hands on, crumbling rock or whatever. So that preservation is an issue there as well. And keeping buildings, watertight and wind tight is one thing, but creating opportunities in which they can be the drivers for change for future generations. One example that I've got of that is the Borough Collection in Glasgow, which is a new building and an old building. An older building, it was actually much more solid than maybe the newer building and some of the challenges that came with that, and the work that they did in creating the new hybrid building in which they're in now. So most of the glass is all energy conserving glass. Not only were they excited to show me all of the exhibitions, I've been to the Borough quite a few times, one of my favourite places, but it was great to hear from the curators and the way in which they did that. The other thing that took me up was up onto the roof to see their big array of photovoltaics and the way that has drastically reduced, including the energy conserving glass, their energy bills. So it's not just about, making sure the fabric of the building is wind and watertight and sustained for the future. It's the opportunities in which they have got reduce their costs and therefore their carbon impact on the environment in which they sit in and using some of these new technologies in order to do that. So they've become they won an award actually for the work that they've done at the Borough, and they've become a bit of an exemplar for other buildings and cultural heritage examples in which they can share that experience, and they're doing that as we speak. So it's not, you can't just put things in isolation in that sense. They're all connected, and they're connected in different ways. And not only has the Borough Collection now got, you know, a building that's going to be sustained for, you know, many, many years in the future, they've also dramatically reduced their energy bills in a point in time when energy is probably the biggest cost impact on any building in any setting that we currently have.
Thanks. I do think you've got one of the best jobs in government in terms of, you know, being able to see some of these incredible
There's
assets.
Not enough time.
Yeah. My other question to Alex Paterson was around just expanding the portfolio. So the reason I asked that first question was just trying to understand, is there at all a trade-off? But I asked, obviously there's a lot of old buildings in Scotland, and it's not feasible for Historic Environment Scotland to own and run them all. And he talked about the process of determining that. But he also talked about the fact that he would actually quite like to change the approach, which has been in recent years, they haven't actually added anything to the portfolio. How do you feel about that? Would you like to see more ancient historic buildings coming into Historic Environment Scotland's portfolio? Or do you think that there are other owners that can run them well?
Yeah, I think all of that. I think community asset transfer is obviously something that I've seen used very effectively right across the whole of Scotland, mainly for community assets. But you could see where, you know, a local community group with some expertise looking after, you know, their historic assets around in their communities. There's a properties in care review that's ongoing right now. There's been extensive work done on that. I suppose Hez would say if we take more properties into your care, it means more responsibility, including financial responsibility. And in tight circumstances, that's a difficult thing to do. And again, that's why that review of the operating model becomes more important, because if we can raise more revenue and therefore more investment, it becomes more straightforward in order to take more properties into care and look after them. And some properties in care are there because they are in a perilous state, and that's the reason why they have come in, and it's about maintaining and sustaining those properties to do that. But I think there's much more that we can do around about community engagement. You know, we've talked about volunteering and how that becomes important. You know, community development trusts, historical development trusts, you know, there's lots of places in which communities can be engaged in all of this. And that issue that I raised at the very beginning of the session about participation then becomes important around that too. One of the issues that we're grappling right now is with churches and historic churches, and many churches in small towns, particularly, you know, in rural areas, are the cultural heritage. So Hez have now engaged a member of staff who's working closely with the Church of Scotland on the challenges that they have and the proposals that they have in order to dispose of some of their historical buildings too. An example of that, again, I'll take you back to my own constituency, is the Trinity Church in Lark Hall Main Street, which is an amazing building with an amazing historical stained glass window, which was removed a few years ago because the stone around it started to degrade and they were worried. There's now a consultation ongoing with the community in that area to take over ownership of that and maintain it, both as a historical monument, but also to maintain it as a community asset too. You know, so it may not be about more properties coming into the care of Hess. It may be sharing the expertise in which communities can look after what's on their doorstep.
Thanks very much. And if I could just, one small little one. I couldn't agree more with you on the suggestion that often visitors know more about our heritage than local communities. And even from a Highlands perspective, whenever tourists come, we always recommend that they go to certain areas or properties, and you ask locals and they're not. How do you think you change that?
So I think that the change is that community engagement locally and how we do more of that. And that's one of the things I think that we will pick up in the Culture Value Summit, is about how do we engage communities more in what is on their doorstep, and how do we get them involved, and how do we get them, you know, getting fired up about them. Now, you will hear a community if they find out that assets closed, which we have heard over the last couple of years, you know, that was a bit of an earthquake in Lark Hall when the Trinity Church went on that list, and people says, "Oh well, we're not having that." So you can really engage people in not just in an emotional way, but you know, in a really committed way in which they can pick up some of that. And I want to develop some of that work with HES and other cultural organisations. And how do we do more of that? I think you're absolutely right. Schools have got a huge role to play here in how we educate young people about what's in their local community. I mean, my lifelong interest in empire and slavery, for instance, was a primary school visit to David Livingstone Centre when I was about 10 years old, and I have never lost that interest, and now have the real honour of taking forward that work in government now too. You know, so these things for a 10-year-old can spark something that becomes a lifelong passion, and I think it's about creating the opportunities in which we can ensure that happens, and we have lots of wonderful young people and older people engaged in the local community. But there's many ways, I think, in which we can do that. And if you've got ideas on how we could do it, particularly for a rural setting, please share. My mind and my ears are open, and my heart's open to any opportunities that you think that we are missing.
Wonderful. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I don't know if members have any other questions. I've got a couple of final questions just on the back of certain things that have been asked. The first of this was to return to the question of mainstreaming, which I think you mentioned, Minister, in your opening statement. And it is a recurring theme that the priorities of the strategy reflect how the historic environment sector is delivering against wider government outcomes, such as transitioning to net zero. And Alex Paterson told us last week that, and I quote, "If the strategy is not to be delivered by the sector only, the funding should not be constrained within the culture portfolio." What's your observation on that? And do you support mainstreaming? I think you do. You support the mainstreaming across portfolios, but do you also support access to cross-portfolio funding?
So, for fear of speaking for my other colleagues in government and a very rough, budget situation that we are developing and going through right now, I'll not answer that one because I don't think I can answer for other portfolios. What I can say is part of the role when I came into this job was to take on mainstreaming into mainstream culture right across the whole of government. It was one of the roles that I had with Equalities and Human Rights, and now I see some of my own works coming back to me from other portfolios, which is always a good thing. I think mainstreaming across many parts of government is not just desirable, it's necessary. And it's necessary from the point of view of take net zero, for instance, you know, the heat and buildings regulations, which, you know, could be a bit, pardon the pun, dry for most people. I found that we had to engage with that because that led straight back to the example that I used of the Borough Collection and how they have managed to turn around their fortunes on that situation. So that's one example. I think I want opportunities to formalise some of that cross-government work, and that includes local government, so that's why that work with the Wellbeing Board and COSLA is incredibly important. But obviously across, you know, National Performance Framework, the wellbeing economy work, which is a huge interest of me, because I don't think we can have a wellbeing economy where culture is not one of the structural mainstays of that wellbeing economy, because actually having those opportunities to experience and, you know, be involved in and just, you know, have the imaginative input of something, you know, that you deem as a cultural asset is incredibly important to people's wellbeing. We've seen that during the pandemic where, you know, people doing their daily walk would find, you know, very interesting and innovative ways to do that. So that wellbeing, so that links straight into health and health outcomes. Many of the sites that I have visited, they've had lots of other, you know, incidental things that are going on there for, you know, the local community. So one site I visited recently was an older people's rambling group who were out walking around there. And when I asked them, what do you get from this? And they says, well, it keeps me mobile. It maintains good mental health. It maintains, you know, social connection. It reduces my social isolation and loneliness. So you can see right across the whole of government where that mainstreaming piece of work becomes incredibly important in everything that we do. It also makes it important in how we take things forward. And an example of mainstreaming Jim Fairley will be interested in this, is that following concerns raised by stakeholders in rural and agricultural policy areas, we worked very closely with them on the draft Agricultural and Rural Communities Scotland Bill, and these conversations actually led to historic environment inclusion in the bill, which would probably have never been there before. But you'll know from your background, Mr. Fairley, you know how important some of these cultural heritages are and how farmers are working around them, and you know other things are being either grown or grazed around them too. So that enabled us to work very closely with that bill and then to preserve the historic and cultural assets in that. So that's an example of how mainstreaming is important in that sort of a day-to-day creating of new pieces of legislation and regulation. But for me, that's one aspect of it. The other aspect is about the health and wellbeing aspect of it. And we cannot do that without having mental health colleagues, without having wellbeing colleagues from Mr. Gray's team and health colleagues from the health team working with us in all of this, because they can be transformational for people in their lives.
I think Alexander Stewart wants to come in with a...
Can I just... it's about accountability and delivery of all of that, Minister. I mean, last week we were told by Mr. Patterson that all of the success of the strategy was built in. So everything was built in to make sure that was the case. But when I asked about data that was being used, what form of data was being used to reflect some of that, they were not really convinced that all the data that they needed was being provided by all the groups in the sector. And from that, how is the Scottish Government going to monitor the performance of HES in delivering that strategy? Because that was also something that we were not clear as to what the process was going to look like.
So I think the engagement on the 13th of November of our data analyst is an answer to your question and a recognition that, you know, that there was maybe lots of data there, but how did it tie together in order to use it to, you know, focus resources or time or energy, or, you know, realise there's a gap there that needs to be resolved. And I think that's an answer to that, around about that. And they will monitor that and obviously report to us and report to this committee. You know, so you have that role of being a monitoring body as well. And I know that you do that very, very, very well. I think another part of this is about inclusion and who's included and how we create those inclusive environments. And that's about making, physical assets, accessible. That's one thing. But you'll have noticed that all of the websites and all of the plans in which we have published, and all of the updates in which are published, they're all available in Easy Read and in Gaelic and other formats in order to increase that inclusion. And I think that's maybe where some of the data gaps have existed. And as much as it's easy to see a physical barrier, but not so easy to see the non-physical barriers and how they tackle that. And I've put a lot of stock in this new person who's doing the data analysis. Again, as the former Equalities Minister, I would not have been able to move forward with many of the actions that I took without having that underpinning data and what it told us and where it told us the gaps were and how we resolved that too. So I'm looking forward to hearing the first update from that person, but we should let him get his feet under the table. It's only been a few weeks.
Thank you.
Finally, Minister, can I ask you about community asset transfer, which has been mentioned? You'll be aware that within Our Past, Our Future, there is a statistic that around a third of all community asset transfers since 2015 have involved a heritage asset, which is, I'd say I was quite surprised it was that high, but I'm very pleased it's that high. But it does bring challenges for the community managing that asset. And there's obviously the initial challenges of acquiring it in whatever way. But there's also a longer term challenge in managing, maintaining, etc. And we heard evidence from the National Lottery Heritage Fund that we should consider providing a kind of longer term safety net to ensure that these transfers are successful. And last week, Alex Paterson said that HES has aligned its grant making to allow for greater flexibility to support community ownership. But is there anything more that Scottish Government can do to help communities that are managing assets in the longer term?
So I think the genesis of the community asset transfer was about community assets. So it's community centres, it's libraries, it's all of that. And I think it's now moving into a new sphere, and part of that is about those heritage buildings that are sitting in communities. And the Trinity Church in Lark Hall is a perfect example of that. And when communities get together and, you know, hold their consultations, decide what they want to do with that. I met with Caroline Clark from the National Lottery Heritage Church just a few weeks ago too, and we discussed much of this and how they align their funding and grant making opportunities for communities. And in some ways, a property not being in the care of a government body, it can attract more. If it becomes a charitable trust, you know, or a constituted organisation, a residence organisation, or whatever it is, you know, that there's obviously avenues open then for additional grant funding that maybe don't come through, you know, government bodies, but come through other ways. And I think hearing from Caroline Clark and Alex Patterson talking about how the aligning some of that will support people, but it's not just about money, it's about the expertise that people need in order to maintain some of those buildings. Because it's one thing, you know, taking on a community centre that's, you know, pretty straightforward. It's another thing taking on that Trinity Church in Lark Hall with the stone masonry issues there and the stained glass window issues there as well. That takes real expertise. And I think we've all been talking about how do we use the expertise that are currently in all of our bodies in order to support those communities to do that work. And I think what Caroline Clark was talking about was some of the grant funding being attached to securing some of that, not conditional, but, you know, attached to how do we give people the opportunities to access those experts in those fields. And on that point, on historic churches, when I met with Historic Churches Scotland a few weeks ago, they were talking specifically about the expertise in which they have in their organisation and how they can, you know, engage community groups and charitable trusts in the work that they do in order for buildings to be taken on by communities and maintained and sustained in that way that needs those heritage skills.
Thank you. Unless any other colleagues have further questions, I think that concludes our evidence from you. Can I express the committee's thanks to you and to Mr. Raftery for attending this morning? And we're very grateful for the evidence you've given. We'll now move into private session for our final agenda item. Thank you.